today, and not just today, but yesterday was better than today because we got a chance to see today. Hallelujah. We thank God for who he is and what he want to be and what he going to be even when you don't want him to be. He going to be just who he is. All right? How many know that God is great? Our God is a great God. He's great. Now, we want some great participation this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And this is one of them.
that's what this next song says. This song says, you're amazing. You're amazing. We're not talking about each other. We're talking about God. The God that hung the sun, the moon, and the stars. That same God can deal with our problems.
Amazing.
Lift to the heavens. Say, you're amazing.
amazing God. Amazing God. You sit high, God, and you look low. And right now you see us in every circumstance and situation that we're in. But you are so amazing to bring us out, bring us through, dear God. And we want to give you thanks this morning, dear God. We thank you for the one that was not able to come, that are online this morning, dear God. Father, we thank you for the one that are still on their way, seeking for a word from you, dear God. We ask that the word that come forth, dear God, let it not fall on deaf ears, dear God. Father God, let us be able to receive, not just receive, God, but be a doer of your word, dear God. Father God, let us be a servant this week, dear God, that we may shine, dear God, and help someone along the way, dear God. Father God, we know that you are the lifter of all heads, dear God. Father God, you said if we would lift up your name, that you would do the drawing, dear God. Father God, help us to draw nigh to you, dear God, that you would lift us up. Father God, you will be the rewarder at the end, dear God. Father God, we ask you to forgive us of our sin. There are some known and there are some unknown. There are some that we have spoken and then some we have not, dear God. Would you forgive us, dear God? And as we lay them at your feet on this morning, dear God, we rest in you, dear God. Father, we thank you again for being such an amazing God. We pray for our pastor and first lady, dear God, and our church family this morning, dear God. Our praise, Father God, is unto you. Father God, let us continue to be those worshipers that you are calling on in these last and evil days, dear God. Father, we love you. We magnify your name. For us in Jesus' name we do pray. Amen.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. We bless your name, oh God. He is a great God and he is so amazing. And not only that, he is a way maker. He's a promise keeper. And we bless your name always.
Miracle worker, promise keeper. to be praised.
Come on in, come on in, come on in, Hedges. Can we celebrate the Lord this morning? Hallelujah. Bless his name. Hey, listen, we're getting ready to go into prayer, but the worship has set the stage for what we're going to pray about today. Years ago, maybe about 39, 38 years ago, when I was seeking God, asking, "Are you real?" I wasn't raised in the church, and I saw a lot of crazy stuff in church, foolishness. And I concluded that's the way it was. But then when the Lord began to deal with me, and I knew it was really God, I said, "Okay, if you're real, I need you to show me." And that's a little arrogant, a little immature, but God knew I was arrogant and immature, and he knew if he got me back then, he would keep me. I didn't know it. So I told him, I said, "If you're real, show me for 30 days between the low FM stations, which I still listen to, which is worship or teaching, and either through the scripture, Bible study, Sunday school, whatever it was, for 30 days, God spoke to me in a way that just, and then I got spoiled when he stopped. And I'm thinking, you know, I asked you to show me, and I was struggling, I'm being candid, attitude, and the Holy Spirit said, "If I have to keep showing you, then you don't really believe." And I've struggled with that even today, because sometimes, can I be candid, I want God to show me. And even today, despite all these years of walking with God, sometimes I get in my feelings and I'll have an attitude when he don't. But I asked the Lord this question years ago, and we're going to pray in a minute. I'm setting the stage. I said, "Lord, I read about your works and wonders in the scriptures, and I get it's a different age, but why don't I see more of those in the church?" This is in 1983. The Holy Spirit spoke as clear as I'm standing in a small, still voice and said, "It is because my people do not believe." And let me share this with you. The reason we're working in the parking lot, Miss Tina, she took off her little dress, Miss, you took off yours too, Missy, is that the first lady and one of our elders' wives can serve. Why can't the church serve? But here is why. We failed as leaders in the church by doing the opposite of what Jesus said. Jesus said, "The greatest among you should be your servants." But hear me now, but today we flipped it to where the greatest don't serve, and those perceived to be the least serve. And serving, even in the house of God, has become something we will not do, because we've gotten above that. And so we literally have to model for you what it looks like to serve. And that means there is nothing on this property that belongs to God I will not do, to include cleaning toilets. But the church today is not even looking like the church. It's a nightclub in many instances. And because it's the nightclub, hear me now, I'm going somewhere. You can come to church and have an attitude because you got to park in the asphalt. You can come to church and complain because you got to walk. You can come to church and complain rather than acknowledging you coming into the presence of God. And coming into God's presence complaining? You don't understand what holy and worship is. And no wonder God isn't moving in your life. And no wonder you're not experiencing the hand of God, the presence of God, and even the power of God. Because we think God is a sugar daddy. God is holy. God is just. God is righteous. And what is coming to the church to include me and you is a spirit of pride, and we're full of ourselves. The reason why I try to preserve them hard and them to provide worship, because if we can find that sweet spot, his presence will come in. Because God knows every Sunday we're catching hell. We've been betrayed. We've been talked about. The job is difficult. The boss is difficult. I'm difficult. Life is difficult. Life is hard. And if the church can't be the church, the one place where I can meet God, where am I not? Where else am I going to meet him? It ain't going to be the nightclub. It's probably not the job. It's not the school. Where am I going to be? So I'm asking you, if you're going to walk with us, and we're not perfect and we're not all that, but pray for a spirit of humility. At least ask him to give it to you. And then when you come on the property, even if whatever is going on bad out there, don't bring it in. Why? Because God reads hearts. God reads minds. I think we think he's deaf or he's blind. He can't see. No, he sees. And if I'm going to be candid, this is not a nightclub. And I get full of myself sometimes too, which is why I'm an expert to talk about it. And it's a shame, but it's the truth. Can I just be candid? But I also understand God gives grace to the humble. Just like he resists the proud. And many of us today came to church today with pride dripping off our fingertips. Dripping off our feet. So Doc is going to pray for a spirit of humility to be authentic. So when we're hearing the word, we're not complaining. It's not my flavor. It's not what I want to hear. Make coming to church about God. It has gotten so bad in our church that typically after the sermon, during the invitation, we'll have 20, 30 people walking out, not even understanding. That's a sacred time for God. And yet, because we are so full of ourselves, and church is about you and not about him, you do what you want. I submit to you, that's dangerous. God scares me in what he could do. You want a reminder? Pray for Florida, who's this week about to be hit again with another hurricane. And thank God an F5 tornado has not come up in Frisco. Doc, go ahead and pray for us.
Father, we thank you, we thank you, we thank you. We thank you because, God, as we've already sang, that you're worthy of our praise. Father, we said that you're amazing, you're an amazing God. And the reason why you're amazing is because there's no one like you. There's no one who eternally exists as three persons, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. The three are co-equal and co-eternal. There's no one like you. There's no one who loved the world so much that you commanded your Son, the Word, to be made flesh and to dwell among us full of grace and truth. There's no one like you. There's no one who cares so much about his church that instead of leaving and abandoning his church to feel like orphans, you, Father, and the Son sent the Holy Spirit to take residence in the life of your church. There's no one like you. How can you, an omnipotent, omniscient, omnibenevolent God who knows all things, have a relationship with people like us who are nothing more than mere dust? It is because you are a gracious and a merciful God. You are rich in mercy and abounding in grace. And because of the truth of who you have revealed yourself to be from Genesis to Revelation, God, we are humble before you this morning. We're humble at the fact that Jesus Christ, the righteous one, the Son of God, was humble even unto the point of death, the death on a cross. He was willing to die in our place and to take our sins upon his shoulders. And because of his grace and his mercy, his penal substitution, Father, we're able to cry out, Abba, Father. We are your adopted children. And because of this adoption, God, we can pursue humility. Father, humility simply means, God, that we think of you more than we think of ourselves. When we take our focus and our gaze off of ourselves, it will give us a spirit of servitude. It will give us a spirit of servanthood. Because, Father, you have revealed in your word, Father, that service will sedate suffering. Father, oftentimes we are suffering because we just don't want to serve others. Father, when we serve others, we take the spotlight off of us and we put the spotlight on them. God, I'm asking you to give us a spirit of service in here. Father, we confess to you that we have fallen short of your glory. We have become content and complacent in a bad way many times. But God, you love us not to leave us where we are, but to pick us up and then to cause us to run on your behalf. Father, it's a good thing to be able to call out to you. It's a good thing to be able to say, God, we know that that spirit of pride, Father, does not need to dominate who we are. All of us struggle with pride. But God, because of the work of the Holy Spirit, you reveal the pride and you give us the ability in the context of community to walk in the newness of life. Father, is new life simply a namesake? Is new life simply nomenclature, an appellation, a title that you've given to this body, but not something that we are pursuing with one another? Because if we are pursuing new life, Father, it will be made manifest through the fruit of the Spirit. No one has to wonder. They see your fruit being manifested. And so, Father, I ask you the power of the Holy Spirit that you would manifest your fruit this morning through us. Preach your word through the man of God today. Show us, God, what it means to not have a spirit of pride, but of service, meekness, kindness, and humility. We need you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
And thank
amen.
God.
Amen. Just for 2 minutes. 2 minutes. 2 minutes.
Yeah. I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. In all my life you have been faithful. Lay down.
gracious Father, we bow today in this house. And Father, we bow in humility. Lord, sometimes my zeal, my passion for your people, it comes out because I'm keenly aware that we're not always aware that you observe us and watch us. And we don't understand, God, holiness completely. We don't understand righteousness completely. And so because all of America and social media shows us doing whatever we want to exalt ourselves, it has crept into the church. And even in me and in us, and sometimes we forget that we were created to worship. Sometimes we forget we were called to serve. We were called to prefer others over ourselves. Lord, the platform and positions is dominating our world because that's what we see. And yet you told the disciples in the kingdom that is not so. And you challenged them not to pursue positions of power and prominence, to pursue you. But this is what you were saying without saying. If they got you, prominence and position would take care of itself. Because our gifts make room for us. We don't make room for our gifts. And so, Holy Spirit, forgive us for quenching. Forgive us for not understanding. Forgive us for assuming that going to church is about us when actually, when we gather in the local ecclesia, it's to worship you in spirit and in truth. So bless your word today in Jesus' name. Hey, for a moment, we're not going to read the whole text for the sake of time. We're just going to read Ruth chapter 4, verse 1 through 4, and then we'll get right to it. Before we read, though, it's interesting that Ruth, her mother-in-law really felt, please stand as you get it, please stand. Her mother-in-law felt the goodness of God had left her. She didn't know the goodness of God was with her even when she lost her husband. She didn't know the goodness of God was with her even when she lost both of her sons. She didn't know the goodness of God was with her when she had no means of taking care of herself and she had to leave Moab, notice this now, and go back where they should have been. But this text shows you that even when we're at our lowest, if we're in him, he has not forgotten about you. Even if the circumstance feels like it, feelings lie, he has not forgotten about you. Even if you're struggling and struggling and struggling, this text says he has not. Come on now. He has not. One more time. One more time. Some of us still don't believe it. He has not. He has not, family. I promise you. Let's read together. Now Boaz had gone up to the gate and sat down there, and behold, the Redeemer of whom Boaz had spoken came by. So Boaz said, "Turn aside, friend, sit down here." And he turned aside and sat down. And he took 10 men of the elders of the city and said, "Sit down here." So they sat down. Then he said to the Redeemer, "Naomi, who has come back from the country of Moab, is selling the parcel of land that belonged to our relative Elimelech. So I thought I would tell you of it and say, buy it in the presence of those sitting here and in the presence of the elders of my people. If you will redeem it, redeem it. But if you will not, tell me that I may know, for there is no one beside you to redeem it. And I come after you." And he said, "I will redeem it." Now, it's interesting. I'm going to come back to it. Sometimes you can say something and you don't even mean it. This guy in verse 4, the very last clause, family, listen, he running his mouth like I do sometimes. And then he find out, you better be seated. Then he finds out, I misspoke. I put the cart before the horse. Have you ever misspoken? Have you ever made a decision and then regretted it? Yes. Have you ever committed to somebody and then once you let them all the way in, you said, "Oh my gosh," then you can't get rid of them? The sermon text that Doc Woods came up for us today, the mark of a real man, promise fulfilled, the mark of a Real man. The what? Mark of a? The mark of a real man is Boaz. You about to see this brother go to work in just a moment. Boaz, as I was meditating this weekend, by the way, thank you all for praying for us. My grandson's other granddaddy, Sam Putney, some of you knew on K104, we eulogized him yesterday at a Friendship West. And so it's the first time my little grandbaby, he's 19, 20, first time he's ever really grieved. And so it's tough for children to lose a loved one. So pray for Ina and the family, the Putney families are going through. But as I meditated, I thought about a person of action. You know, Superman was a person of, you know, Batman, back in the day, Batman, you know, he was a person of, and then that was a green guy. Now, he was a nice guy until he got mad. And then all of a sudden, through his anger, he would turn what? He would turn, what was his name? Oh, not just Hulk, but the Incredible Hulk, because when that Joker turned green, he went into action. And Boaz, if you will, he didn't turn green, but he's a man of, so a person of action is someone who is proactive. Can you say proactive?
Proactive.
Decisive. Can you say decisive?
Decisive?
And takes initiative. Can you say take initiative?
Decisive.
To achieve their goal or address problem. This type of person is known for turning plans into ideas, into reality rather than merely discussing or thinking about them. In my 20 years in the military and 40 years of service in the ministry, it has given me firsthand observation of men and women of action. Now, can I tell you, everybody is not a person of action.
Amen.
I'm going to say it one more time. It's a secret. Everybody is not a person of action. I got an amen in the house. Praise the Lord Jesus. So just in case you didn't know what a person of action was, let me give you some traits. One, they are proactive. In other words, they anticipate needs and challenges and act on them without someone having to ask them. If you have to be asked all the time to do what you should already know to do, you're probably not a person of action. Number two, decisive. They display little or no hesitation when they figure out, I gotta go do it. They're determined, they're responsible, and here's something about a person of action. They don't make excuses. Now, there is a time to make excuses, but when it's time to go to work, that's not the time to be making excuses. They're persistent. They follow through. Can I tell you, it frustrates me if I ask somebody to do something, and then I got to remind them to do what I asked them to do. See, I'm not the one to waste time because I'm dealing with people literally all over the world and the land. And if I'm going to give someone my time and it's precious and you don't appreciate it, I got people that want my time who deserve it. At least in a natural sense, over thousands of people. And then a person who's over nobody will not take advantage. There's a difference between the idea of commitment and the reality of commitment. A person of action knows the difference because you can agree to the idea. See, this guy in verse 4, he agreed to the idea. But then when he found out, oh, there's a catch, he didn't want it. Number four, they are end result focused. They are solution oriented and can be frustrated with too much talk about problems. They see the end result and prefer action over excessive analysis or debating. We meet to talk about doing something and then we do nothing. And then we meet one more time to talk about the meeting, to meet and we still do nothing. Oh, some of y'all know people who talk a lot and do very little. Y'all know some of my family. Ooh. I hope y'all ain't watching. Goal-oriented. Being motivated by a clear vision, mission, goal, or aspiration when starting, they prefer having at least one clear goal. Why? Because accomplishing one thing can motivate you for the next thing. They don't eat the whole elephant. They find little things they can do to keep them motivated to go to the next thing because hurdles are necessary to complete the big. Yeah. Typically, they have markers to measure and celebrate. Boaz, a man of action, number one, takes action on the promise he made. Look at verse 1-4. Now Boaz had gone up to the gate and sat down there, and behold, the Redeemer, Mr. So-and-so he's called, of whom Boaz had spoken, came by. Who came by? Mr. Who? See, he didn't have a name. This guy's in a position to have a name, and yet the Bible don't mention him because he blew the opportunity he had. And if you're not careful, the Lord may present something to you, but because you can't see, you will walk away from it. See, Boaz saw something as a man of action. This man, who was a man of inaction, saw, didn't see. Notice this now, verse 2. And he took 10 men of the elders of the city and said, sit down here. So they sit down. Then he said to the Redeemer, Mr. So-and-so, Naomi, who has come back, she's what? Come what? From a country of Moab. She came back in a bad way. She thought the goodness of God was gone. But now in this chapter, the woman we met in chapter 1, oh, sister girl skipping and laughing. Because she's realized God didn't really leave her. She just felt like it. Her situation just looked like it. Family, you can't go by your feelings or what things look like when it comes to God. Because the Red Sea is a situation that looks like you can't get across. But if you're in faith and trust in what with God, he can part them Red Seas. Verse 4. So I thought I would tell you of it and say, but it buy it in the presence of these sitting here and in the presence of the elders of my people. If you will redeem it, redeem it. But if you will not tell me that I may know, for there is no one beside you to redeem it. And I come after you. And he said, I will. Redeem. Notice what he said. He said, I will redeem it. Now, Boaz, the man of action, is proactive. He has a goal in mind. He gets up. Listen, so now remember when we left last week, Naomi told Ruth, she said, Boaz ain't going to rest. I know ain't going is not good English. Y'all know from Mississippi. Mississippi, the country boy come out every now and then. I know ain't going good English. But he ain't going to rest until he do something about our situation. So Boaz gets up. But notice what Boaz says in verse 13, though. This is what Boaz says in verse 13 of chapter 3. This is what Boaz says. It's man of action. He says, he's talking to Ruth now. He says, remain tonight and in the morning, in the what? If he will redeem you, good, let him do it. But if he will not, if he is not willing to redeem you, then, notice this now. This is Boaz, man of action. He says, as the Lord lives. Now, family, you should not be invoking God's name just to be doing it. And you should be careful about your yeas and your nays. You really, really should. But notice he said, lie down until morning. In other words, he said, Ruth, I know y'all got some concerns, but I'm a man of action. And you don't know me, but in the morning you're going to find out. So here it is. I'm sure Ruth and Naomi, though, because Ruth went home and Naomi asked her, how did it go with Boaz? And Ruth telling her, and I'm sure they couldn't even haul his sleep. They woke up on this particular morning right here in chapter 4, and I bet you they couldn't wait to get dressed. Naomi, who in chapter 1 didn't want to get out of bed. Naomi in chapter 1 said, the Lord has turned against me. Naomi in chapter 1, woe is me, nobody loved me, and because life was hard. But what she did know is God had a plan. And she thought God was like people. He was incapable of fixing things that were broken. She thought God was like people. He was incapable of turning things around. She did not understand God can resurrect the dead. God can take broken and see, I know we can't put Humpty back together again, but I promise you, God can put Humpty Dumpty back together again. Probably jumped up out of bed wondering how this day was going to end because they now have hope and anticipation. Why? Because a man of action is on the job. Boaz, a man of action, went up to the gate. The gate of the city was always the place where the influential and honorable men of the city met. It was a type of courtroom or a combination of city council chamber and courtroom where judicial matters were resolved by the elders or those who had influence or respect, confidence, honor in the community. So Boaz took a seat. He gets up early in the morning in faith. He went to the gate for a day, and it's not like it's like going down to city hall for us. And so he goes down to City Hall anticipating that business people were going to come to the gate because that's where they went to observe and communicate. So he sits down, and lo and behold, when he's there, guess who shows up? Mr. So-and-so, Mr. No-Name, Mr. Non-Man of Action shows up. But he's in a position to be a man of action. He's in a position to be the redeemer, to be the goel, to be the one who takes the family in brokenness and help put them back, what, together. That was his role, secondary role, but it was his role. But it was great timing. Isn't God good? Now listen, family, he don't always come when we want. But can I tell you, there's been enough time in our lives to where he has indeed come through. He has indeed showed up. He has indeed worked out what needed to be worked out. Yes, he did. So he goes, he sets down, and then Mr. So-and-so shows up. And then once, now imagine, you know, Boaz is sitting down and Mr. So-and-so sitting down. I'm sure he's thinking, why you want me to sit here? Boaz, being patient, understood, before I tell you, I got to wait till some others come, some witnesses. Can you say witnesses? Yes. Now, I don't know whether he sent and got the 10 elders, witnesses, or they just came on their own. But look at the timing of God. Yes. Naomi thinking in the beginning, God just don't love me. And now in chapter 4, God is saying, girl, child, if you only knew just how much I really loved you. And I'm using you to be a story that people can read down the road. Can I tell you, if you give up on God when your story is bad, you won't be a story people can read down the road because you were giving up too quick. You got to hang in there with the good and the bad, and the bad and the good. Otherwise, your story is only good. You have no story for bad. All of us need some bad. Why? It's humility. It's dependency on God. Without pain, you wouldn't seek God, some of us. Without pain, you wouldn't love God like you should. Without pain, you wouldn't walk in humility. Look at verse 3
now.
Then he said to the Redeemer, Mr. So-and-so, Naomi, who's come back from the country of Moab, is selling the parcel of land that belonged to our relative, Elimelech. That's Naomi's husband. So check this out now. Understand in context, God had a vision different than today. When God gave land, when they came into the promised land, the land was divided up into groups and then in individuals. And when an individual got a piece of land, if they couldn't afford it and they had to sell it, a redeemer could buy that land back and placehold it. And here's the thing about God. That land would be placeholder for 50 years, but after 50 years, you got to give it back. Because the Lord wanted to make sure that his people were owners. Can I drop something right here? It's going to hurt. We've been deceived in assuming depreciating assets is our value, when in fact, appreciating assets should be our goal and aspiration. Because all of us have made at least $1 million, making 20, 25,000 over about 15, 20 years, you've made $1 million. But if you're spending it on depreciating assets, you'll say to the Lord, you ain't took care of me. And he said, no, you spent it on stuff that has no value after 5 or 6 years. Okay, that's enough. So, and that's Leviticus 25, 28. So this land that Elimelech owned, even though he was in Moab away, the land still belonged what? To him. And a redeemer was to buy the land, but they were going to placehold it for him. That's the way God worked with his people. So notice now in verse 4, Boaz is setting this thing up. Boaz says, so I thought. Now, Boaz is a wise man, y'all. He's not showing all of his cards immediately. He's sitting there, Mr. So-and-so, no-name dude, Mr. No-Man of Action. He's got these elders there. So, you know, Boaz, in a smooth way, I'm sure, maybe not, but maybe, this is what he says. He says, so I thought, I will tell you about it. Notice now, notice it's in the text, y'all. He says, by it in the presence of these sitting here and in the presence of the elders of my people. Now, there is a chance Naomi and Ruth, they done got themselves up. And there's a chance they, now we don't know, but they may be there as well. Because people came and they observed these matters like a courtroom. Y'all see Judge Matt, that you don't go to the courtroom, but some of y'all watching. You know, back in the day, Judge Judy, yeah, some of y'all. See what I'm talking about? So there were people who went to the court session to watch and observe. There was a chance they were there watching this going back and forth. And then Boaz says, buy it in the presence of these sitting here. And I'm sure Mr. So-and-so who has a little money, you know how we get when people say, you know, you want to buy this car and you got the money to buy it. It's a good-looking car and it's going to be a bargain. You know what he probably said? Yeah, I'll take it. But he didn't know there was a clause hidden. He didn't. Listen, family, you need to understand this now. Boaz is a man of action, but he's working to keep his promise. He said this, either I'm going to redeem you and Naomi Ruth, or the one who's ahead of me is going to do it. Either way, before the day ends, I'm going to what? Get this thing done. Can you imagine what the world would be like if more of us were people of action? Who, when we said we was going to do something, you could go to sleep. But what happens is often when men tell you they're going to do something, you don't sleep because you know they ain't going to do it. They just... Mama would say flapping them gums. I know that's a old school, that's a whole new term. Flapping them, in other words, they just talking. Boaz was not a man who just what? Talk. Boaz was a man of action. So Boaz agrees he could be the Goel, but he says you are in a position to be the kinsman redeemer, to care for Ruth and Naomi, or to buy this land. And he assumed, so the kinsman redeemer family, so that you know, and we're different today, depending on the family, is to assume the responsibility for the family at large, for the property, but also positioning for even generations to come, because that land needed to stay with the family. Does that make sense? That's a big, big responsibility. But that was the Jewish culture. Mr. So-and-so wanted the property. Can you say he wanted the property? What he didn't know, though, is that there was a catch with the promise he made. He says, and listen now, he done said it to the elders, he done said it to Boaz, and I don't know how many people behind him, but he says, I want the property. Okay, point number two. Boaz, a man of action, is bold and clear on expectations. Look at verse 5 in the text, 5-8. So then Boaz said, the day you buy the land from the hand of Naomi, now that sounded good so far. But now here comes the clause. You ready? You ready for the clause, family? You also acquire Ruth, a Moabite, an outsider. People that God said have nothing to do with. Just, you know, hood rats. I'm not saying they were, but, you know, I'm using vernacular y'all use. Oh, okay. I'm sorry. He said more about the widow of the dead, and the dead is a key word here, the dead, in order to perpetuate or continue the name of the dead, the father, her father-in-law, her husband, and even her brother-in-law in his inheritance. Then the Redeemer said, I can't do it. I thought you said you wanted it. Well, I want the land. I don't want the girl. See, sometimes the man don't want the girl. He just wants the girl actions, attributes. Sometimes he wants the girl. He don't want the girl kid. Sometimes he wants the girl. He don't want the girl crazy. He didn't know she was crazy. But if you want the girl, you got to marry her as is and take the crazy along with it. Because I promise you, when Miss Tina married me, she didn't know back then that. I'll at least admit it, y'all. I'll admit it. She didn't know. That thing is crazy. Thank God I got saved and submitted myself through study and prayer. Then I say prayer, lots of accountability, lots of Bible studies. Sister Ida McBride, whose pastor I sit under at Friendship Baptist Church, I was assistant pastor and him, and pastor held me accountable in a great way to help me mature and grow up. Some of y'all crazy too, you just won't admit it. Everybody know you crazy but you. Under your hood, there is no spark plugs, no carburetor. You need a mechanic. Jesus is a mechanic. If you let him, he'll fix you, my brother. He'll fix you, my sister. If you let him, if you let him. How do you know, preacher? Because if he can work on me, he'll work on anybody. Now, because Naomi was older beyond the years of bearing children, the near kinsman was not expected to marry her. Because that, you know, she's not going to have any kids, no biggie. And now Ruth is thrown in, and that means if I marry her, and Mr. So-and-so may have been married with kids. I don't know if Mrs. So-and-so was there. But he may have been married with kids. And then if he had kids, I'm now taking on a responsibility to marry this woman. And then when her son grows up, the land I bought, not my kids get it. Her kid get it. Mr. So-and-so said, that's just a little bit much drama. And even though all these people looking at me, I'm just going to gracefully bow out, y'all. And I'm going to let this thing go. Boaz shared this was a package deal if someone was going to exercise the right of kinsman redeemer towards the deceased Elimelech, who was the father, the husband of Naomi, the father-in-law of Ruth. He had to fulfill the duty in regard both to the property and to the well-being of the future of his bloodline. This was a legal matter. And Boaz, even though it wasn't a legal matter, it was a moral matter, because biblically, this was the son or the brother, but there was no son or brother. They were relatives, but it was a moral issue. And Boaz, even though it wasn't his primary responsibility, he's assuming it. And sometimes, family, you assume responsibility even if it's not yours to assume. Why? It's just the right thing to do. We use the excuse, well, that's none of my business. Well, you're talking about it, so you've already made it your business. They over there hungry and he laid off, ain't got no job. The fact that you put your mouth on it means go get a biscuit and take it over there. Okay, let me persist. Boaz, this wise man of action, played this thing. Mr. So-and-so in verse 6 declines to be the kinsman redeemer. He said, I want the land, but I don't want the woman and the responsibilities. He had no idea, though, that God was involved in this. And that Boaz's name would be known throughout history. And he would be just Mr. So-and-so. And nobody would even know his name. Some situation God may be teeing up for you may not be about the moment. It may be about down the road. But before God gives you all the details, he wants to know, can I trust you with the details? In this case, he couldn't trust Mr. So-and-so with the details. Now, we don't know whether Boaz prayed about this, but what we know for sure is Mr. So-and-so certainly did not. He quickly said, no, I don't want this. He didn't say the woman, but that's what he meant. I want the land, but I don't want the responsibility. If he'd have just went off and said, Lord, I'm uncomfortable, I need to talk to some elders, get some counsel. No, he quickly, because of emotions and because he couldn't see the big picture, he quickly said what? No. No. In fairness, though, Deuteronomy 23 talks about the Moabite people and how God told them not to even associate with these people. He said, don't deal with them at all. But what God didn't say is, you can't deal with a person who changes their heart, who changes their mind, who changes their soul. Just because you came from a family of brokenness doesn't mean you as a person must be broken. Just because you came from a family of struggle doesn't mean you have to be a person who just keeps struggling. You don't have to follow the pattern of your family. You don't have to follow the pattern of your past. You can make a decision. I will be the one who will break things, who will change things. I will be the one who will chart a new course. So Mr. So-and-so was not a man of action. So this is what happened in verse 7 and 8. Now it's clear he don't want to do it. Look at verse 7 and 8. Now this is the custom in former times in Israel concerning redeeming and exchanging to confirm a transaction. The one drew off his sandal and gave it to the other. And this was the manner of attesting in Israel. So when the Redeemer said to Boaz, buy it for yourself, he drew off his sandal. Now this doesn't make any sense to us. But in Scripture though, family, in Deuteronomy chapter 25, we won't talk about it. And this is not our culture, please understand, this is their culture. But if a brother died and he had no children, his younger brother was to take his wife and she was to have a son to ensure that his brother lived. And so this is what this is about. And so there was a woman named Tamar and a guy named Judah. Attack will come to that in just a moment. But Naomi is not the first Gentile woman in the bloodline of Jesus. She's the third. And then come along Mary later. But God strategically placed some Gentile people in them. We've said this in Bible study. Doc has said it. I've said it. He placed some Gentile people who the world saw don't belong here. Who the world said she was a prostitute. This woman worshiped other gods, Ruth. What is a Moabite woman doing here? See, Boaz knows this, and yet he's overlooking it. But guess who his mama was? His mama was a prostitute. Boaz's mama. And he knew when they came, and his daddy married his mama. You know how y'all are when stuff ain't done right? Psst, psst, texting, calling. Boaz had some understanding of compassion. He had some understanding of what brokenness looks like. Because even though he's an insider, his mama was a what? Was an outsider. Mr. Inside, Mr. So-and-so, I'm sure he was just a man of the people, man who was inside. Can I tell you, God wants you to have more than just your experiences? And there is a phrase, some different authors have wrote about it, that it's good for us to have some blood on us, some pain, some sorrow, some brokenness, so that God may call you aside to relate to people who've been divorced, some people who filed bankruptcy, some people who've been violated. Some people who have abandonment issues because everybody abandoned them. No, there are some people who won't know your story and can't even relate to your story. But there are some God specifically set aside and put them through a lot so that you would have a witness and somebody to walk with you in your pain and not abandon you so that when you get strong, you can play it forward or go back, whichever you want to do. And so I want to say to you today that this man did not want to assume the responsibility or be accountable, but Boaz did. And he took off his sandal, symbolizing that I publicly, in front of witnesses, don't want to do this. Now, in Deuteronomy, if the brother didn't want his brother's wife, not only was the sandal taken off his foot, she would spit in his face publicly. And see, some of y'all right there would be disqualified from being a Jew. let somebody spit in your face because you didn't want the responsibility or the accountability. And yet this Boaz character, this man of action, let me wrap this up. My last point, Boaz, a man of action, is not just responsible, but he's also accountable. And I know sometimes we think those two words go together. They're different. Give me a minute. So check this out, family. I'm going to go back and read this, and I'm going to connect these dots. So here it is in verse 6. Then the Redeemer said, I cannot redeem it for myself, lest I impair my own inheritance. I don't want to mess up my family. Take my right of redemption yourself, for I cannot. It wasn't that he couldn't. He what? He didn't want to. He says, for I cannot. No. That's a play on word, homie. You can. You just don't want to. Verse 7. Now, this is the custom in former times in Israel concerning redeeming and exchanging to confirm a transaction. The one drew off his sandal and gave it to the other. And this was the manner of attesting in Israel. Verse 8. So when the Redeemer said to Boaz, buy it for yourself, he drew off his sandal. Verse 9. Then Boaz said to the elders and all the people, you are witnesses this day that I have bought from the hand of Naomi all that belonged to Elimelech and all that belonged to Chilion or Chilion and Mahlon or Mahlon, whichever you prefer. Boaz is saying publicly, I'm going to assume responsibility to the people as witnesses, but I'm also be accountable to God. Did you hear what I said? See, you can be responsible, but then there's no accountability. See what I'm saying? You can be responsible for cleaning up your room, but do you actually clean it up? That's your responsibility. Y'all got kids right now. You got to count to 100 to get them clean. 1, 10, 20, 85, and they sitting there asleep, and then at 99, they wake up and go, okay, now that mama done counting, I'll go wash the dishes. I can't count beyond 2, y'all. I'm sorry. I just wasn't raised to count to 100. I just wasn't. But look at verse 9 and 10 as we wrap this up. And so here it is, verse 10. And Ruth also the Moabite. Why? So that we can perpetuate the name of the dead and his inheritance, that the name of the dead may not be cut off from among his brothers and from the gate of this native place. He says here, you are witnesses this day. Boaz assumed responsibility before witnesses. But then, because remember, early on, he said, as the Lord lives. He invoked God's name early. This is not just about him and the witnesses. This is not just about him and Naomi and Ruth. This is also about him and who? God. Somehow this man concluded that God was in this thing. Watching this Moabite woman come back with her mother-in-law, knowing that she was trailer trash. She wasn't, but you said in the vernacular today. Knowing that she was going to be talked about as an outsider because her people worship other gods. They were mean to the children of Israel. Ruth came back knowing all of that. And then, family, she gets up the morning they arrived to go looking for work, and Naomi didn't go with her. And I'm sure when she arrived, there was a chance at least 2 women. How she was dressed. And at least maybe 1 man who was working on this field looked at her. And she pushed all of that aside. And worked hard from day. I mean, just worked hard to the point that she stood out. And then at some point, she got Boaz's attention for her work ethic, for her focus, for her sacrifice, for her commitment. And he said, I haven't seen many that would push through, walk through all of this. Just for Naomi? What kind of woman is this? Something about Ruth. Sookie, sookie now. That's old school. Oh, now. I don't know what it was about sister girl. But there was something going on that made this man say, even in front of all y'all, I'm willing to take it all on. Oh, my. Did I say... Ruth gave up everything. She left her own family, her own country to follow Naomi and didn't know how things would work out. In faith, she didn't just want to be with Naomi. She wanted Naomi's people and she wanted Naomi's God. And at some point in her making that decision, Naomi's God decided, I'm going to be her God.
ahead the blessings of Abraham, whom she either don't know or find out. The blessings of Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, they're going to start following her. And I'm going to start parting some Red Sea for her. I'm going to start opening up some closed doors. I'm going to start doing some things that people are not going to be able to understand. And I'm going to put her in the bloodline of Jesus Christ. You want to know why you want to serve? You want to know why you want to be faithful? Because most people do not get God's attention. If you want to get God's attention, you can't be like everybody else, doing what everybody else is doing, going where everybody else is going, driving what everybody else is driving. You're going to have to chart your own course if you want to get the God of the universe's attention. Ruth had nothing. Ruth had nothing. And somehow, God looked over hundreds of thousands of Jews. Nope. 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 Yes! Don't you think he don't see you? And some of you have been going through for a while. If you take inventory of how much you've took, you'll know you're strong because you'd have gave up a long time ago. And maybe you're tired from carrying, but baby, you're still carrying. Thank God you got the strength to still get up and carry. Thank God he trusts you enough not to buckle, not to quit, not to get. Thank God you're still here. Many people are already gone. You are still here. Still here. And you don't know when, God. You don't know when. You don't know when. You don't know how. You don't know where. You need to trust God. And if you don't, say, God, help me to trust you. I don't understand. I don't even want to. I don't feel like it. But if you... I'm not preaching, family, what I've heard. I've been walking with God 40 years. In sin and in righteousness, on the mountain and in the valley, in sickness and in health, in life and in death, but I'm still. And some of you, just like me, you've been through, but you are still. Let me give you these two tidbits. I'm gonna take my seat. She embraced Jehovah God, and Jehovah God embraced her. Did you hear what I said today? So in 11 and 12, the witnesses gave a blessing. And it says all the people. This is weird to me. How can all the people? See, when it's a sweet spirit and God is present, he'll break the yoke. The text says the witnesses and all the people. When God's hand is on you, even people don't like you know there's something different about you. Even those that talk about you know you got something they don't have. It's just talk. Be a woman, man of action. Because the majority, all they're going to do is, God ain't looking for the majority. Never has. He's looking for a man or a woman who can go against the grain when he says go. A man or woman who will stand by themselves when others go. And typically, pastors, men, it ain't men in the Bible, it's women. Yes. Deborah had to lead the men because the men didn't want to go. When I need no sister to amen, but it's okay. It's the truth anyhow. When Jesus was on the cross, it wasn't the brethren. They were fishing, watching football. Then they go ahead and give an example. They gave a blessing, said, like Rachel and Leah. Rachel and Leah became the mother of the nation of Israel. These two women together had 13 children, making up the 12 tribes of Israel. They asked that that blessing be along them. And then they mentioned a guy named Perez. This is a weird story. I got to read it on your own because I got to go. In this story, one of the brothers is in the womb. Midwife is there, you know, getting ready to get the baby. And an arm pops out. And because it was twins, she put a, you know, something around the baby's arm to differentiate the oldest.
But then the arm goes back in, and somehow in the womb, Perez jumps out ahead of his brother. And she said, wait a minute, your brother was the first, but somehow Perez, who was last, came out first. And Perez wound up being instrumental in the scriptures. Read on your own. It ain't always how it looks. It ain't always how it starts. When God is involved, it's very seldom how it looks. Because if I can see it always, it ain't God. Because walking by faith is not what I can see. Walking by faith is what God sees. He ain't showed me yet, but I gotta walk to see it. And sometimes we don't wanna walk because we wanna see first, and God says, no, go and then see. No, we say, no, I wanna see and then go. And we back and forth. Boaz, a man of action. What's a man of action? Proactive, decisive, persistent, end result, goal oriented. Can I tell you, family, there was one more man who was a man of action. Not just any man. He was proactive. He was decisive. He was persistent. He was goal oriented. And even though I was no good, he wanted me. And some of you were no good, but he wanted you. He was decisive. He was proactive. He was persuasive. And he was what is his name?
Jesus.
What is his name?
Jesus.
What is his name?
Jesus. Yeah, 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 yeah. The name of Jesus. Jesus! Jesus! Amen, amen, amen. Oh my gosh, oh my gosh, thank you, Lord. Oh, I preacher ain't preaching about what he heard, he preaching about what he know, and what he done live. Bless God. Oh my gosh, family. That's the God we know, love, and serve, and his name is what?
Jesus.
His name is Jesus. And as we learned today, he put Ruth in that bloodline. God was at work. And because Jesus was in that bloodline, it's about the blood. And with it being about the blood, there is no other name, no other name by which man can be saved except the name of who?
Jesus.
We're going to enter into now, family, a time of invitation. I'm going to ask our ministers and prayer partners to come forward. And as the Holy Spirit is speaking to your heart, whether you're watching online or present with us today, I just want to remind you that we serve and know and love a God who is a God of action. And he sent his son, Jesus Christ, to do something. He took responsibility for your sin, for my sin, for the sin of mankind. Jesus Christ put on a flesh suit and came to this earth. He always existed with God the Father, God the Holy Spirit. He was God the Son, and yet he humbled himself. Pastor talked about humility, and he put on a flesh suit. And he came to do what we couldn't do for ourselves. So he presents to you this morning the only way to heaven, the only way to God the Father, the only way is Jesus. So if you haven't made a decision to accept Christ as your personal Savior, to in humility repent, turn from your sin, and turn to God, Jesus is the way. He's the only way. And we want to give you that opportunity this morning. If you need prayer, like all of us do, and you need to repent of not being responsible, not being accountable, we invite you to come this morning. If you're searching for a church home and you would like the covering of Pastor Hutchins as your spiritual covering, and you'd like to make New Life your church home, we invite you this morning. To our right, we have our intake team who are ready to receive you. And if you'd like to be baptized, we also invite you in, but respond to however the Holy Spirit may be speaking to your heart this morning. If you don't know him, a simple prayer of faith, confessing your sin, acknowledging that he came and he died. He took responsibility and was accountable. He hung on that cross and died. And on the third day, he rose again. And because he did that, our Savior Jesus lives. And he's inviting you this morning because he was accountable and responsible for every sin you would commit, every sin I would commit. And believe me, they are many. And he washes you clean through his blood. We'll bow for prayer and we'll worship, but allow the Holy Spirit to speak to your heart. Bow with me. Father, in Jesus' name, thank you so much that, Lord, you are accountable. You are responsible because you loved us. And seeing how you pulled Gentiles into your flock, thank you for making a way for us. And so this morning, if there's anyone who has not accepted you as personal Savior, who has not repented or confessed of their sin, Holy Spirit, speak to their hearts right now and let them know a simple prayer of faith, acknowledging that, Lord, I'm a sinner. And I repent now. I turn from my sin. I say I'm sorry. And I accept you and what you did because you loved me. And you were accountable and responsible to take on my sin problem. You're the only way. So, Lord, I invite you into my life. I surrender my life. Humbly, I come before you. And I acknowledge that you died on that cross. That you were buried. And on the third day, you rose again. And by praying this prayer, you can. And you will, and you have saved me. Father, for anyone else this morning who is in need, anyone else who is tired, anyone else who wants to meet the one true and living God and be encouraged, Holy Spirit, speak to their hearts. Let them know that they are loved, they are valued, and you're present right here. And in your divine providence, you said, today, son or daughter, I want to remind you how much I love you. Holy Spirit, speak to hearts. May they respond to you now. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for your peace and thank you for your power. As we worship you now, in Jesus' name, we all pray and we say together, amen. Please come as we worship.
Sin.
the living word. And that same spirit of acknowledging him, Jesus, Jesus, he is the living word. As we acknowledge and worship him, the name of Jesus, we acknowledge that he is the living word. And as we continue in worship, this being a first Sunday, we observe communion, the Lord's Supper, because he is the living word. So I would ask you to stand as we prepare our hearts and minds to receive of the fruit of the vine and the bread representing his blood that was shed for us, his body that was broken for us. You should have your communion elements with you. If you do not, raise your hand. Our ushers will make sure that we get you one. And his presence and his spirit is just so sweet. We in no way want to quench the spirit. So we continue to acknowledge him, the name of Jesus, as we prepare to worship him through the Lord's Supper, the communion experience. And it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23, it says, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' And in the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.' For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Goes on to say that we want our hearts in our relationship in alignment with God. We want to be right to partake of the fruit of the vine and of the bread. So let's take a moment. If there's anything in our hearts and minds, for those who are believers, who have accepted Christ as their personal Savior, repent, confess anything that would be in the way of your relationship with him as we prepare to partake. Bow with me. Well, Heavenly Father, Daddy, Abba Father, Lord, thank you for the sacredness of your presence. Lord, you are a holy God, and we acknowledge you this morning. We acknowledge your presence. Holy Spirit, thank you for being present with us and meeting each one of us in our hearts right where we are. And so, in our desire to be in right relationship with you before partaking of this holy sacrament, Lord, collectively and individually, we repent of any sin by thought, word, deed, or action that has caused us to break fellowship with you. And Lord, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. We receive that forgiveness. We receive that renewal. We receive that new life only possible through you. So we acknowledge you now, Father. Bless us as we remember your body broken for us, your blood shed for us. And as we look forward to your return, we know you're coming back, Lord. We know you're coming back. We remember you now in Jesus' name. Amen. Please take the bread, break it, and partake. That bread represents his body broken for us. And likewise, would you please raise your cup? The fruit of the vine representing his blood shed for us, covering us, cleansing us, putting us in right relationship with him and right relationship with the Father. We raise the cup to our Lord in honor of him and in remembrance of him. Please drink. There will be some receptacles passing through where you can take care of putting those elements inside. And as you're doing that, we're going to continue our worship experience. We're going to continue and move right into our time of giving of our offering and our tithes. So as we prepare for that, if you've given those in the receptacle, let's praise our Lord for remembering him today, for preparing to give, for wanting to bless his holy name. And as we prepare to give, you'll know that there are three ways to give. You may be seated. Three ways to give. You see it there on screen. At the back of each row, there is a giving envelope, and there's also a QR code if you'd like to be electronic and utilize that. But if you'd like to actually fill out that envelope, drop your tithe or offering in. We do have giving stations out in the lobby, so we encourage you to drop those off. You can also go online, follow that QR code with Easy Tithe and be able to give that way. Or you can text to give, 214-378-3730. And those are our opportunities to give. And again, we want to be faithful. We want to be obedient in giving back a portion of what God has so generously given and blessed us with. So let's bow for prayer. We'll ask for God's blessing and grace on what is given. And again, we worship him through our giving and through our obedience and our surrender, first of ourselves to him, and now of the resources that he's blessed us with. 100% belongs to him. He only asked for a portion back. Let's bow. Well, Father, thank you again for the sweetness of your presence. And as now we have the opportunity to worship you through our giving, Lord, we pray that you would bless these tithes and offerings and gifts that are given unto you for your kingdom. Father, thank you for New Life Community Church. Thank you for the local church where, Lord, we're able to give. And we know that the kingdom work is happening here, that we will lift up your wonderful name and bring the good news of the gospel throughout this community, that we will continue to meet needs, multiply what is given as we give in obedience, as we give out of love, as we give out of sacrifice, and as we give out of thankfulness and gratefulness and humility, because all that we are and all that we have is because of you, Father. So we honor you now in what is given. In Jesus' name we pray, and we say together, amen.
September 29th till October 27th in the lobby. Tribe thanks all of you in advance. Please join us for the New Life Community Church Outreach Fellowship Potluck. Saturday, October 19th, from 1 p.m. to 4 p.m. inside the gym of our multipurpose building. This event is open to all who participated or contributed to any 2024 outreach events. Please join the prayer ministry for a Thanksgiving prayer vigil on Friday, November 8th. At 7 p.m. in the multipurpose building gymnasium. The annual New Life Community Church picnic is next Sunday. Please dress comfortably and join us after service for an afternoon of food, fun, and fellowship.
So I am here today at New Life Community Fellowship here in Frisco. This fantastic team of volunteers here are in the process of serving their community. They're loving, serving, and helping.
I like to volunteer because it's great helping people, and I enjoy doing that.
I love serving the community. I love to be a smiling face for someone. You just never know what type of impact you might have on it, and I just love fellowshipping with my brothers and sisters in Christ.
The New Life Community Church Outreach volunteers have a passion for serving. The outreach ministry and our impact as a church make a difference in the community as we pray, pour, love. We are looking for more volunteers to join. Come and help others with your hearts, time, and effort. Please contact Stephanie Washington at thechurchthatpours.com.
Amen, amen, amen. How about a praise clap for our Lord for meeting us here today? Woo, did our pastor bring that word? He preached that word. He done lived through something. He done been through something. Like he know God. He done walked with God. Hey, family, we're going to go ahead and pray and let you out in just a moment. But I do want to remind you, again, please join us next Sunday for our church picnic. It's going to be immediately following service. It's supposed to be warm, so remember, dress comfortably so that you can go out there. It shouldn't be too hot. It'll be comfortable enough for you to enjoy. But dress appropriately, and we're excited to be able to have some food, some fellowship, and some fun. By applause, are you going to attend next week? All right, all right, all right. We'll see the peeps and sheeps out there. Also, we would ask if you'd like to bring a donation of a dessert or a drink. We thank you in advance for that. And you can also make monetary donations if you'd like. But just remember to come dressed for outside comfort. And then also, October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. And the Women of Faith would like to welcome you. Okay, let's go ahead. Breast Cancer Awareness. We got some survivors who have been healed and made whole. Jehovah Rapha, Christ our healer. So our Women of Faith, they want you to worship in pink at our service on October 27th. So please come dressed in pink in acknowledgement and support and prayer for not only survivors, but those who are going through breast cancer, because we're trusting and believing. We're speaking life. We're speaking health. We're speaking healing. We're speaking wholeness to everyone who's gone through cancer. We're praying, trusting, and believing. So as we wind down, we want to acknowledge any of our first-time guests here at New Life Community Church. If you're a first-time guest or a visitor, would you please stand? Don't be shy. We just want to show you a little love. Please stand if you're a first-time. Over there. Oh, my gosh. All across the room. Show them some love, New Life. Show them some love. Well, thank you for worshiping with us today. We're going to take a moment, just take about 10 or 15 seconds to welcome you. New Life, give somebody a fist bump. Take a look at our first-time visitors. Welcome them in and show them some love. About 15 seconds. Counting down. Calm down. We got to get you out of here. Got to get you to go pick up them babies. All right. Everyone, please stand. Please stand. Please stand. We're going to say our mission together, and then we'll pray and let you go. On the count of three, let's read together and say it like you mean it. Say it like you believe it. Say it like you live it. Let's say it together. One, two, three. We are New Life Community Church, living in God's Word. We pour hope into the community. Bow with me for prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you again for meeting us here. Thank you that we leave differently than when we came in, because we've been in the midst of your presence. Thank you for healing. Thank you for hope. Thank you for changing all of our hearts. And Father God, thank you most importantly for Jesus. Now go with us and go before us as we depart this place, but never your presence. May your blessing, your grace, your peace, your mercy be upon us, that we might be accountable and we might be responsible for the one true and living God, that we get the privilege and opportunity to know, love, and serve. We thank you together. And Lord, in Jesus' name, we all say amen, amen. And thank God.